Everything's great. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the real news here. If any of us can handle it, if our nerves can handle it, and I include myself in that, I'm in good shape. That doesn't mean that I don't go down. I do, but I bounce back more quickly. Okay, so it's like that. I'm still suffering in lots of ways. I've been suffering from nerves but able to rebound, minimize the collateral damage. It's just being in great shape. My weight's really good. Everything's great. I'm still getting pounded, but it's like a big wave breaks on me, and I get thrashed by it. But I come out and I feel I'm disoriented, but I kind of get it back together in time to paddle out and not get hit again. Whereas if I wasn't in such good shape, I'd get doubled up on. Another wave would hit me, and then when you get doubled up on, in surf terms, getting doubled up on means you get held under by one big wave, and then just as you're coming up, or even before you come up, another big wave hits you, and so you get held under twice as long. That's what's really dangerous. So we can handle getting held under by one big wave, but we don't want two to hit us. So I've been hit by a really big wave the last week or so, and getting held under by that, the wow of that, the shock of that, the shock, really, the shock. So last night, I realized I was in trouble. Yes, it's like, you're being held under the water, and you realize, hey, I'm running out of oxygen here, so I need to get to the surface. So what I did was I took a very strong step. I realized I was stalled out. My nerves were all shaking. I said, hey, okay, I'm in trouble here. What do I do when I'm in trouble? Really in trouble. I said, okay, let me take the most drastic step here. And I turned and I called upon Padmasambhava for help. I asked Padmasambhava for help. I said, I got to go. I want to go to Padmasambhava for this one. So I went to him, asked for help. Now, it's a strange dichotomy, sort of, in that I find that to be ecumenical is the strongest position there is, because I can go to Padmasambhava directly, and it's actually more effective for me than a Tibetan Buddhist going to Padmasambhava, because I come to him with open mind, open arms, transparent, honest, just meek, and just say, Padmasambhava, I need your help. That's it. I don't have any expectations. I didn't even know who Padmasambhava was until recently. Right? So I don't have all of those religious expectations. None. None. It's like a little child calling for their parent. You know, they just have faith that the parent will answer. They don't really have all these built up stuff. It's just honest and say, help, I need help. So, you know, the way I look at it is, for people like of other traditions, they would have more success with Jesus than Christians would. If they just went and said, Jesus, I know you're tremendously helpful, and so I'm just asking you for help. They don't have any of the baggage of the religion of Christianity. They don't have any of the expectations. They just go like, they're open. And so I really recommend going outside of your religion, actually. Don't abandon your religion, but be ecumenical. So I didn't turn to Jesus for help with this. I turned to Padmasambhava. And I find it easier to do that. And Padmasambhava is arguably on the same page as Jesus in terms of historical importance and success and helpfulness. I mean, you know, who do you put above Padmasambhava, really? There's this page where there are these few, you know, tremendous notables in history, and he's one of them, for sure. And in terms of action, what he did is quite astonishing. The same with Jesus, but and same with Buddha, etc. Right? There's a few there. But for me, I mean, there's no question that Padmasambhava is you could put quote unquote greatest of all time. You could put that to his name, couldn't you? You absolutely could. So, going to him for help is it's not easy. I haven't done it very often because he responds. I mean, in terms of responsiveness, he's just again on that small page, right, of the top, the very top. When you go to Padmasambhava with an open arms and expectations and just help. You don't have any expectations of how he's going to help or anything. Just say, I trust that you're going to give me the right help. That's all. That's all. I need help. He's going to help you for sure. For sure. So it's very, we tend not to go to those types just because we're afraid of success, right? Yeah, we're more used to being stuck. See, I kind of more comfortable being stuck here, but I said, I just can't be stuck, Padmasambhava, right now. It's going to destroy me. I mean, so I need success. So I know you're going to give me success. And of course he did. Of course he did. He said, just do it like this. Play it like this. It's like a great caddy on a golf course. You see, the caddy knows the course way better than you do. It's like playing Augusta, the Masters, and just for your first time, you get a caddy that's been caddying there for 30 years, and has had past champions and everything. Just do what the caddy tells you to do. You don't say, "Huh? What am I going to do with this shot? Huh? I don't really know." So not, just say, "Hey, caddy, how do you want me to play this shot?" And the caddy says, "Well, play it out to the back of the green, right side back of the green, with a lot of spin, and it'll draw the ball back down. And it'll tend to go back down like this." I mean, he will know exactly what shot to hit for you. And so just trust the caddy. Just trust the caddy. I remember I once had a caddy only one time, but it was very interesting. He said, play this putt out 6 inches, and I looked at it and I said, no, I see a different line. So I hit the ball, missed the putt. If I'd have done what he said, I would have made that putt. In other words, they know the subtleties and the breaks and how it plays out. Okay, just do what the caddy tells you to do. So it's a really big help if you don't have this arrogant attitude, like, "Well, I know what to do, but I just want confirmation from Padmasambhava or something." No, I said, "Padmasambhava, how do I play this next shot? You tell me. You tell me, and I'll do what you say. I'll do what you say." So this is a huge, huge benefit. So that's one of my major secrets to success, keys to success. Is I'm ecumenical. When I'm stuck, I'll go to someone that I'm not going to have any expectations, and I'm not going to give them any attitude, or I feel like whatever they say, I'm going to do. And so I work around the problem of structure and expectations in this way, and get really immediate direct help, and then hit the right shot. And so people are wondering, "Wow, I mean, you're really hitting the right shots." Well, because I'm getting advice from these great caddies. I'm doing what they say. It's not me. I just do what they say, basically. And as when I start getting in my own way and thinking I know how to do it, then that's a problem. So it's tough to go to for me to go to straight to Jesus. I do sometimes, yeah. He's absolutely, but other times I feel like there's so much pressure from Christianity to say, "Well, we know what Jesus would tell you, so listen to us." And then, it's wrong advice. Wrong advice. They don't know. So it's better than to say, "Okay, well, I'm going to go to Padmasambhava." And this takes me completely outside the box, right, of all cultural expectations. And I don't know anybody who can tell me what Padmasambhava is going to say. And if that crops up, I'll go to Ramaharshi. If that crop, go to Nandamayama, go to Longchenpa, go to Jemmy and Kenzi Choki Lodo, go to Manjushri, you know, and keep shifting. I keep shifting so that these expectations cannot pin me down. And I can actually... Got it? Okay, we got it. So, now my nerves are more settled. He took the pressure off of me. He said, this is to take the pressure off. He says, you already know, but just do this. So he said, don't choose between the ocean of samsara and the peace of God. Instead, choose wow. Choose wow. And forget about this choice between samsara and peace of God, nirvana. Forget about that choice. You're not making that choice right now. You're making the choice for wow. Make the choice for wow. Immediately, I felt the pressure coming off of me. I felt this pressure coming off of me. It's like a caddy reminding you, hey, you got this shot, remember? This shot? And you're kind of confused, like, I'm not sure. He says, no, just hit that nice little fade that you have. You know, like a five-yard fade into this. You know, just hit it, you know. A little descending blow, get some spin on it. You got that shot, right? I said, oh, yeah. I kind of forgotten I have that shot. He said, just choose the wow. I said, oh, yeah, right. Be oblivious to trying to choose between truth and lies. That's way too much pressure, isn't it? I said, yeah. Just choose wow. That's my choice. I choose the bridge. I'm going to hang out on this bridge for a little while. I said, I'll enjoy this bridge. Look at this bridge. The bridge of wow. Yeah. So instead of telling me, oh yeah, you've got to choose the peace of God, Pavasama said, no. You choose the wow. Choose the wow. So, this has been very, very, very helpful. California day, clearing up from the storms we've had recently, the rain. It's kind of cold, cloudy, but we're headed into another dry spell with beautiful weather. We know that that's stretching out ahead of us for, could be a week or so. It'll be a little unsettled for a while, but we're headed towards sunny, clear California weather again. So that's a good thing. I say, okay, it's something to look forward to, right? Choose the wow. Just choose the wow. It's like dieting. At some point, go back to eating. Like, what do I do? What do I do? I don't know. I was on this severe diet recently. It got down very low, 167.2. That's the lowest I can remember being. And but then I couldn't sleep because my shoulders start aching, and I got pain in my hand here. My driving was super painful. Somehow I lost some sort of padding or something. I don't know what. But when you really go on a very, very crash diet and really go down low, there's a backlash to it. There's a backlash. Yeah, I felt really nimble and light. I started having all these pains and I couldn't sleep. And so what happened was I started eating again. I went back to eating. And I gained 3 pounds. 3 pounds. I'm now like 170.2 instead of 167.2. But I feel a lot better. I feel a lot better. But I'm trying to cap it. At 170, I'm trying to cap it. Before I had it capped at 173, but now I'm trying to cap it at 170. So this is how it goes. The spiritual path is amazing how everything sort of parallels itself, isn't it? This dieting thing, in getting down to 167, I really had these spiritual breakthroughs, peace of God, and tremendous breakthroughs. But I couldn't sustain them quite. I couldn't sustain them, and I couldn't sustain the 167 weight. Okay, but I know I can get there. You see, I know I can get there, and it's and I feel okay, but I'm gonna have to get there a little more slowly, so to speak. So I went back to eating. I even ate some potato chips yesterday. That really puts the weight on, doesn't it? But now today, I'm saying, okay, now I'm going to back off of all that eating. I was eating like a bunch of sandwiches and bread and, you know, a lot of kind of heavy food to get back a little bit of bulk. I needed it. So the same thing on the spiritual path. I got to the peace of God. I got to it, and I got to this tremendous clarity. But what happened was, I said, oh my God, what can I do with this? I can do so much with this. And then the jitters started coming up. Just overall, the overall jitters started coming up. Because my expectations have just completely shifted, you know, completely shifted. So what I need to do now is go back to the wow and saying, I'm not choosing the peace of God, and I'm not choosing the ocean of hope and fear. I'm not choosing either one of those. I'm choosing wow. I'm choosing just wow. And I'm comfortable with that. So I'm not going to be, you know, choosing to be, you know, really light. And I'm not choosing to be, go back to being heavy. But I'm just sort of in the middle of that, right? Neither one, neither one, neither one. I'm not choosing hope and fear. Neither am I choosing the absence of hope and fear. I'm choosing wow. So it's this tremendous spiritual technique that has been advanced here. And it's funny. I wanted to stabilize at 169, but then I decided to push it down to 167. And in doing so, I went back to 170. So now I'm going to go back down to 169. Okay. But the trending to lighter weights, trending there. So overall, it's a plus. Overall, it's a plus. But I got a little greedy. See, I got a little greedy there. I wanted to see, is it possible to get to 167? And I found out it's possible, but you have to do it in a slightly slower way and let the overall body adjust. Let it adjust to 169. So it's the same thing, the peace of God. Let the body adjust to the fact I can get it. Absolutely, I can get it. And I will get it. I will get it. But I need to be a little patient, a little patient. Because I have to know what to expect about how things are going to go in the world and with me and all this. And so that I'm working on that. I'm working on that. I say, oh, I got the peace of God. But, you know, then what? Wow, I'm so light and agile and just, you know, and what's going to happen? So I've been working on that a lot. And what I've said is it'll enable me to turn the page into a new chapter. It'll enable all of you to get a look at a new chapter. Okay, I will be able to turn the page to a new chapter, and you'll be able to get a look at that and say, "Huh, it's possible. Maybe I can do that too." And it'll start to that confidence will start to build in the rest of you here in the world. And then that momentum will start to roll out throughout the world. It's already rolling out, actually. I already started it. And it's amazing what's happened already with me. Amazing how much I've already gone through and processed. I mean, I've really been putting myself through the ringer as far as experiencing of what's going to happen when we turn this page into a new chapter and set the past aside like it never happened, because our interest is now in this new chapter. It's really extraordinary what happens. It's like back to the future, really. Yeah. However, we're in a different position now, because we don't need to choose between the peace of God and hope and fear right away. we can choose, wow. So what happened with me, I pushed it, I decided to go for it. And so I did, I took these actions that meant I'm going for it. And I experienced what the backlash or what happens from that. And so I've been rocked by that, definitely. Facebook. Put all 300 pictures of Sri Sri Ananda my Ma. Pretty much new pictures that no one's seen before. And this really was, rocked the world, so to speak. It was really made a splash. And I was thinking, oh my gosh, here it goes. Well, great momentum in the world and all this stuff. But the reaction, what actually happened was at first very puzzling. And so I've had to work that out. And I've been able to, with the thanks of Padmasambhava here coming. I had to call upon Padmasambhava to help me out with this, to help us out with this, not just me, us. Because it really was quite a shocker, actually. What happened was, I started getting all of these friend requests from females, call them females. The feminine, so to speak, females, yeah. But it wasn't at all what I expected. I thought all these spiritual females, energy would go high, I would bring out the best in from the female. And that didn't happen at all. Just the opposite happened. Or something very different happened. I started getting I was told to confirm everything. Whatever, and whoever asked me for a friend request, confirm. And then I said, okay, well, what do we have here? And then I began to assess what I have. And really what happened was I got all these requests from these females who are just these sex goddess sluts, basically. They're just trolling on Facebook. Like prostitutes, whores, sluts, sex goddesses, back to the 60s. They're all with makeup and, I was like, what? It's like these are 60s women, early 60s women, right? But back to that, so what happened? What is this? And they message me, hi, and they try to get into a conversation, and they start saying some pictures, and I just said, yeah, I'm not interested. And then I delete them as friends. I unfriend them. That's what happened. And I'm like, I said, Sri Sri Ananda my Ma, I thought that this would, like, advance women, spiritually advanced women to a great extent. Instead, we just went back to the early 60s here. Okay, so that's one facet. It's like, wow, what's going on? The other facet is I'm into early 60s music. Dion, especially. Dion DiMucci, the best of early 60s. The king of it. And there's one song, Donna the Prima Donna. I've been listening to it over and over, and it hits a chord so strong. I said, my God, that's a powerful, powerful, powerful song. Spiritually, it's alerting me to something. It's showing me something. And so I'm taking a look at the 60s and I'm going back to that and reliving it. And I'm realizing, how terrible it was. It was terrible. I said, okay. So why are we going back to the future? Which is what is happening. We're going back to the future. But I was able to say, okay, I don't want that. But I certainly don't want what happened really. You have to say, since 1973, the last 44 years have been this full-on new chapter. We turn the page on the 60s and that whole scene. And by 1973, we had just really dropped it all. Okay, and so we've gone to this new chapter. And this new chapter has now come to an end. With the spring equinox in 2017, that's done. That's done. And so we're now in a new chapter, actually. It's a new chapter. So this chapter is going back to the future. And I'm like, whoa, wait a minute. But is it really? Is it really? So I've been dealing with this situation here. And I'm saying, I don't want either one of those. Wow. But I was able to deal with these females. Uh, in the right way. I wasn't hostile towards him or anything. I just said, huh. And I said, no, I'm just not interested. I said, don't, what's the matter? Don't you want to talk? Don't you want to, you know? They're like, you know, they're really aggressive in terms of, you know, we got to do this. I said, no, I'm not interested. Thanks. No, not interested. So I was very kind to them. You know, I was kind. And they said, well, you don't want the, you know, Donna, the prima donna, you know, the spiritual women pretending to be spiritual, which is what they've been doing the last 44 years. They're just faking it. I don't want that either. I said, well, you must want us to be like, you know, the sex goddess, 60s sex goddess thing. You know, just these, yeah. I said, no, I don't want that either. And it's like, huh. You know, so there's just like, wow. But I'm not rejecting it. See, I'm not rejecting it. I understand. Where do you go when you reject, when you realize that this last 44 years have just been same old, women faking it. And so, see, what the benefit of hindsight that I have is very strong, actually. Because the truth is, the last 44 years, all this female, you know, women's feminism, women's spirituality, all this stuff, it's just women faking it. They're faking it. But they're super good at faking it. Now, maybe if you're younger, you don't know, but before the sexual revolution and feminism happened, the 60s and the 50s, all that happened. And what happened, what ended that whole thing was women, females, basically, coming out. They came out of the closet and said, look, guys, there was a phase of honesty. He said, honestly, this whole time that we pretended that you were like these wonderful male studs, you know, making us happy and doing it, you were the source of our happiness and everything, we were faking it, the whole thing. We were faking the entire thing. And they came out and were more honest about it, you know. And this was, you know, absolutely devastating and shocking to men. Because men thought they were, you know, the source of the happiness. The males thought they were the source of female happiness. And yet all the while, the females were just faking it. Faking sexual pleasure. They were faking the whole thing. Absolutely faking orgasms, faking everything. They said, oh, you're so wonderful. Faking that the man, they're so in love with the man. It was all, they were all faking it. Pretending, faking the whole thing. And so that brought a collapse to the 60s. It brought a collapse to it. And so what happened was then men said, oh my God, I don't know what to do. You know, shocker, shocker, shocker. But the women said, don't worry. We're into spirituality now. And then what men did was they shifted over to being these spiritual teachers, spiritual gurus thing. Same old dance, right? Same dance. And then women then faked like, oh my God, you're such a great teacher. I'm getting so spiritual. I'm getting so spiritually high. You're, you know, oh, what a great guru you are. I love you so much and stuff. Same dance. Exact same dance. And they're just faking all that too. And so, like, now we're going, oh my God, we got to go back to the 60s now. And so men are, you know, what is that thing? There's some phrase for it, that now women are into these guys that are, you know, like the 60s guys, the 50s and 60s guys. And they say, oh, you're so great. Now this is what I really like. I don't know. There's some TV show about Mad Men or something. Mad Men or something like that, you know. You know, the manly man with a cigar and all this stuff, and the women are swooning, they're back into swooning over that, right? They're not swooning over gurus anymore. Some of them are, but that's all fake, guys. Okay? It's all fake. All you guys who thought you're really pumping up the women with, you know, they're making such great spiritual advancements, you're teaching them, you know, all this great spiritual Tibetan Buddhism and all this, you know, and they go to Rishi Kesh, and they've got all their clothes on and beads, and their hair's done, you know, in the spiritual. Oh, I love you so much, Guru. Hug me. You're from the heart. I can relate to that so much. Guess what, guys? They're faking that too. You see, women, females are the great fakers of interest. Like, I'm so interested in fixating reality. I'm so interested in fixating freedom. I just swoon over it. No, they don't. They're not really interested in it. But someone has to fake it. And so the feminine aspect of this dream of spirit is faking it all. They're faking interest in it. So, but the guy thing, the male thing, is to believe that the female, feminine, the female thing, faking interest is real. That spirit really is interested in this. Oh, so this then motivates them to innovate. And without that, the male aspect of the dream wouldn't innovate at all. They'd say, but I'm not interested in it either, actually. I thought you were interested. And so it's this thing. It's like the males say to the females, I thought you were interested. And the females say, no, I thought you were interested in it. But neither one is really interested in it. Okay? Neither one. But spirit has to play out this dualistic trick on itself. It says, no, I thought you were interested. No, I thought you were interested. No. Oh, my God. So that's how it really is. So, fortunately, I wasn't really caught up in either of these things. I wasn't caught up in the manly man thing of the 50s and 60s. You know, the guy, you know, the guys that, you know, we conquered the world. You know, we can do anything, man. Look at we can do. Business, inventions. Wow. And the women are like, oh my God, you guys are like unbelievable. You're so unbelievable. Just being with you, I'm in ecstasy. You know, I just see you and I just swoon. You know, you're so amazing. It's all faking. Total fakery from females. And I wasn't caught up in the guru thing, spiritual teacher, and swooning over these, you know, you're so spiritual. You're so spiritual. I can't believe how spiritual you are. I was never caught up in that either. Because I was looking at the whole thing from a different standpoint, just saying, you know, this feels all bogus to me. It's just all BS, bogus stuff. BS, bogus stuff. You know, it feels like it's all fake. It's all fake. All this, what's going on here? You know. So I've been able to unravel it all. Been able to and see through it here. So I can turn the chapter. I can turn the page. But now, you know, the females will say, "Oh, okay. Well, we'll go back." Oh, so you're interested in you know. Us being the sex goddesses, and you're these super manly men. I said, no, I'm interested in the wow. You see, I'm interested in the wow. Now, this is very key. In order to turn the page, you have to have this bridge of the wow, where you're not interested in either one of those. You acknowledge both, and you're not mean to both. I'm not mean to either one. I'm kindly to both, but I say, I'm just not interested in either one of these. I'm not interested in the sex goddess, and I'm not interested in the spiritual goddess. Okay, neither one. And they say, well, you must. What are you interested in? I'm interested in the wow, the wow. And the whole gay thing is just another play on that. It's another just fakery. It's just fakery. Also, is say, so we would say, oh, you're not interested in us. Well. Okay, you can be interested in men, women, but pretend they're a man. You know, be interested in females still, but just pretend that they're a man, like that. And so that's just, you know, just a clever little spin-off on the whole thing. That's all fakery too. That's all fakery too. Totally fake. Just, yeah, faking interest. It's like they say, okay, guys, you're not really interested in us as a sex goddess or as the spiritual goddess. Well, okay, just be interested in men, but it's really us you're interested in. You know, you can do it that way. We'll let you do it that way, and then the guys get, you know, pulled into that too. They get pulled into it. It's just something you get pulled into, just like you get pulled into the manly man for the sex goddess. Men get pulled into that. Males. And then males got pulled into being spiritual males. Like, okay, I'll be the spiritual guru teacher. And then they get pulled into being the gay males. Okay, they get pulled into that too. All three of those are bogus, okay? Because it's the whole feminine thing and all that is just fake. They're just faking it all. Because the feminine is still in the whole gay culture, totally, right? Totally. They may call it campy camp or something, but it's still totally there. And it's all fake. It's all fake. So I'm kindly to that too, but I'm just not interested. And another thing, I also on Facebook, what happened? It wasn't only the sex goddess thing. Also, all these gay men also friending me. So many. It's like 90% either gay men or the sex goddess thing. And I'm not interested. Yeah, I was very nice to them. I just not interested. And they kind of go, huh? They all kind of go, huh? Like that. And Facebook is absolutely full of these people, these three types: the feminine spiritual type, the feminine sex goddess type, and the gay male type. Okay, full of it. I mean, it's like 90%, or maybe 99%, actually. And so I'm nice to them all, but I'm just not interested. That's all there is to it. For my interest is in the wow. That's it. That's the only interest I have, actually. I'm not even interested in the peace of God, to tell you the truth. I'm only interested in the wow. That's it. Not something causing the wow. The wow is its own wow. The wow is causing wow. Okay? The wow is causing wow. So this has enabled me to turn the chapter on it all. Which is a big wow in itself, isn't it? It most certainly is. Now, all the Don the Prima Donna, as Dion sings it, Charms, diamonds, pearls galore. She buys them at the 5 and 10 cent store. She wants to look like Zsa Zsa Gabor, but she's really the Donna next door. Okay. Charms, pearls, bangles galore. Okay. Well, in the 60s, that's literally the way that the females express themselves. Is like, I mean, they would just, they were just dolled up with charms, diamonds, pearls galore. And they wanted to look like Zsa Zsa Gabor. She was the ultimate sex goddess of the 50s and 60s. Zsa Zsa Gabor, darling, look at me, darling. I'm just dripping with charm. Look, and you move me, darling, beyond into ecstasy. It's just unbelievable. What a man you are. But only the manly man can do this for me. And it's this whole thing. But do we not understand that it's the exact same thing? The females now expressing as these spiritualized females, it's just the Donna next door with all these charms, bangles, pearls galore. Now they've got the mala beads, the beads and the pendants, the turquoise pendants, and the bangles have just changed the way it's still all charms. What was it? Charms, diamonds, pearls galore. Yeah, charms, diamonds, pearls galore. It's the exact same thing. It's still the Donna next door. Hasn't changed at all. And this wire, this freeze up. I hope it keeps going here. This is unusual for this to freeze on this. Yeah, okay, it's still going. Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. So instead of the dime store diamonds, they have now dime store, mandalas or what do they wear? Malas. And it's all still dime store stuff. It's all still dime store. 5 and 10 cent store. She buys them at the 5 cent. You go into these new age bookstores, new age. Oh, let me buy this. Let me buy this. Okay. It's still the Donna next door. Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. And now they go to the gurus and say, oh, guru, you're such a spiritualized guru. You make me swoon into the heart. This. It's all bogus stuff. They're faking it. It's all fake. They're still the Donna next door. They know it. But the guru doesn't know it. Although the guru's kind of scratching his beard, and like, what the heck's going on here? You know, maybe I'm not as guru-ish as I thought I was. I don't know. She's kind of looking like the Donna next door. You know, I thought she was some spiritualized goddess. I thought I taught her to be this spiritualized goddess, but I kind of think she's the Donna next door. Wow. Maybe my guru shtick is up. You know? And listen, for the manly men in the 50s and 60s, it was a tough thing, man. And they couldn't take it. So what did they do? They went into being hippies. They said, okay, now what do women want now? What are they interested in? Oh, they want me to be these gurus, Eastern gurus. I better grow my hair long, grow a beard, wear a bunch of linen clothes, and jump around and chant and you know, pretend, you know, I gotta be the guru now. And so that's what the guys got into, spirituality. And then the women said, oh, okay. Wow, this is great. You're amazing. I'm so interested in you now. And so some of these guys have really gone all in on it, and now they're these gurus in the world. And they don't see that it's dawning on them. It's like, oh, but they don't know what to do. They feel trapped. I can see this. It's obvious to me. I saw one super famous guru, and I happened to see live streaming of his satsang. It was amazing. It just popped up on my Facebook page. I wasn't looking for it. I said, what the heck? There's so-and-so. Oh, my gosh. He's a friend. He's a friend of mine. I like him. You know. And I said, oh, well, let me look. And the first thing that was there was this unbelievably dramatic situation. It was so surreal. And I said, oh, my God. And it was a jaw-dropper. And it was the Donna next door just putting on these spiritual airs, and it was so obviously fake that she was blowing the whistle on the entire thing. And here's this guru, and he's just like going, oh, heck, yeah. And it was so intense. I was like, and then after a while, I said, that's enough. I don't want to see anymore, man. I saw enough. I saw what's going on. It was just so totally obvious and clear. I don't want to rub his face in it, you know. It's okay. What do we now? What do we now? You know what? How can the whole situation be helped out? I mean, it's just the cover was blown. The whole cover was blown. And it was painful. It was painful. I felt sorry for him. It was painful. But what an unbelievable! The woman, the female, did this unbelievable job. I mean, the goddess came upon her. I mean, the spirit of the Dharma Kings came upon her. And she put on this act, song and dance, that was just astonishing. Everyone in the room was mortified. I mean, everyone realized the game is up. The game is up. Everyone. They were like kind of shuffling their seat and kind of nervous, said, what the heck is going on here? Busted, you know. And the guru, he just saying, he's like sitting there, I'm busted, you know. I'm busted. What's next? Is there anything next for me? Yeah, there is. So the next chapter is already rolling out. Guys and gals, the next chapter is already rolling out. So I didn't wait around to see him mortified anymore. I said, wow, I got to get to work on this, man. Because he's a really cool guy. He's a really cool guy, you know. And we all are. We're all really cool. We're all fabulous, actually. We're all fabulous. Because again, the females will ultimately say, guys, we've just been faking interest in fixating reality all along, from the very beginning. And the guys will also say, hey, gals, the truth is, we were just faking interest in you the entire time. We're not really interested. We were never really interested in your interest at all. And only then can it really resolve. I mean, the only way that, for instance, the females can really respond to anything and be helped at all is when they realize the guys are simply are not interested in their interest in them at all. And guys tried to do that by going gay, and that didn't work either at all, did it? Did not work at all. Because they're still interested in the feminine interest. They're just using a guy as a front for it. Okay? So that doesn't work. So that's, you know, part of history. It's in the past. All of that's in the past. All of that stuff. It's only when the gals can realize that guys are really not interested in their interest at all. See, for me, I'm only interested in the wow. That's it. And the wow is interested in me. But that's it. I'm only interested in just wow. That's all. So it's only when we get interested in the wow. That's neither this nor that. And center ourselves in this wow. We're not choosing either this or that. I'm not interested in fixating reality, and I'm not interested in reality. Neither one. Only that enables us to stabilize ourselves. The shock of truly losing interest in trying to fixate reality. Because when we say we're interested in neither one, we're also saying we're not interested in fixating reality at all. But the shock comes from that, isn't it? Big shock. As well as the shock of, I'm really interested in reality. So is there just this collective shock of it all, where we just feel paralyzed? And if we think we have to go to one or the other, then the nerves will hit us and we'll freak out. People, well, what happened was, reason why I'm really bringing this up now is because it became to my attention that suicides are starting to happen. It's And I said, wow, we got to get this rolling here. It's amazing. Not only was I alerted to this on Facebook, but on my YouTube channel, the same time that this happened on Facebook, I realized, oh my God, this is so serious. I got to do something about it. A comment popped up on one of many old YouTube videos about, you know, how the world is so lousy. I mean, it's terrible. Why are we interested in this place? And the guy said, you know, we're trapped here. And the only solution is suicide. He put this comment up. It says, the only answer, suicide is the only answer there is. And I immediately jumped on and said, whoa, not so fast. Not so fast. There is a way. Wow is the way. Wow is the way. And Padmasambhava told me, I asked him how, he said, wow is the way. That's the way. This is the new chapter. We're not interested in either one, but we are interested in the wow. And the wow is just this wonderful abstraction. It's kind of like the definition of abstraction, actually. So we're still holding on to one definition, and this stabilizes us, our nerves. Stabilize the jitters, but it's just the definition of pure abstraction. It's the definition of freedom, so to speak. It's just a definition of abstraction. Just one definition is just wow. And I'm still interested in this, and so I'm going to hold on to this is what interests me now. And then this enables one to stabilize in seeing through the whole sham of it all. And there's really nothing, you know, guys can do. The females are always just going to be the Donna next door, you know. And you just say, wow, I'm not really interested in the Donna next door, actually. There's nothing you can do. You know, you can dress her up as a sex goddess. You can dress her up as a spiritual goddess. Or you can dress her up as a man, you know. But she's still just a Donna. Not the Jonna. You know, you can dress up as Jonna next door, but she's still the Donna next door. That's all she is. And you're not interested. And so this is the shock. You're really not, where spirit's really not interested in fixating reality. It just has a familiarity bias, is all. And so that has to be dealt with effectively. And this is the what has been brought in by the Dharma Kings helping me out so I can be helpful to everyone, is this familiarity bias is the real problem, that spirit is unaware of it. But when spirit sees this, it says, oh my God, I really do have this problem. I kept, and they realize I don't have to keep playing all this fake. I don't keep faking interest. Oh my gosh. But I do have this problem. That's what the problem is. So I don't have to keep generating fake interest. I can admit I'm not really interested at all, but I am interested in this one problem of familiarity bias and how to solve that problem. So you do maintain some, you know, interest in working on a problem. And that's the key to salvation, actually, is you maintain continuity, okay? You maintain interest in working on a problem, okay? You maintain interest in at least some definition, but so you have the, wow, oh, what a beautiful definition. It's just, I'm still interested in just this, but just one definition, all the others really don't even interest me at all anymore. It's just this totally abstract, formless feeling of just, wow, it's just, wow, 360 degrees, though, and you, that's all you're interested in. This is the way now. This is the new chapter. This is the new chapter. And I didn't get mad at all these face people because they helped me. I don't get mad. Everything is for me is the grace of God. So whatever happens, that means that being is being super helpful to the Dharma, actually. So I bless them. I say, thank you. You've done a great service for everyone because you tipped me off to what's going on. So this woman that was doing this song and dance for this guru and just blowing the cover of the entire situation, and people are like taking pity on her, you know, like she's mentally deranged or something. I didn't take pity. I said, my God, this is all an act. This is like genius. This is the real goddess here putting on an act through this female. And it was a genius act. This is like Sri Sri Anandamayi is doing this, really. This is how I felt. Holy cow. So my reaction is very different, you know. I didn't pity her. I think, oh, she needs help. Poor woman. She's mentally unbalanced. No. I said, this is like super grace of God happening right here. It's over, you know. She blew the whole cover of the whole situation. And it's funny because the whole I was aware of it. This was Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma doing this. Because there's a picture of her in this satsangs there, this guru. She's on the wall. And I was looking for her, the picture in the wall, and then suddenly I realized, she's not on the wall. She's playing through this female right here. Because only she could do this type of song and dance. It stunned everybody. You're never going to see a female act like that. You know, it was like just uninhibited. It was just like a mad woman, actually, you know. But she was doing it in such a spiritual way, you know. She was just play-acting spirituality. Like, here's this woman, I'm female, and I'm faking spirituality, and look how amazing it is. And yet, she overdid it to such an extent, we all realized, oh my God, she's faking it, you know. Wow. This is just, it just blew the cover on the whole thing. That's Sri Sri Anandamayi. That's exactly what she would do. And she did it. So you want to know, how is Sri Sri Anandamayi helping the world? She is immensely helping the world. You never know what she's going to do, but she can do anything she wants to do, actually. So that was like, I mean, how did that pop up my Facebook? I have no idea. And it was streaming. I said, what the heck? I didn't click streaming on it or anything. It was just suddenly the streaming from Rishikesh, the streaming satsang suddenly appeared on my Facebook pages. I was sitting there kind of in the doldrums. I said, what the heck? I said, well, I'm not interested in this guru anymore. But then there's this woman there. I said, what the heck is she doing? And so I started to watch. I put on my headphones. I'll watch for a while. Boom. Because I've been praying for, you know, grace of the Dharma Kings to help out. Sri Sri Anandamayi, help us out. And she did this devastating help. And you know, I was willing to hang in there with it. It was embarrassing to my friend, and you know, to be outed like that was embarrassing. But I said, don't worry, brother. I got your back. You know, Dharma Kings have your back. It's okay. It's okay. It's something that has to happen. It's okay. So I hung in there with it, but it was tough on my nerves. You never want to see a guy put into such a situation like that. You know, it was kind of brutal, but necessary. You know, I almost felt sorry for him, but I said no. Never feel sorry for anyone, okay? It's all grace. It's all grace. Why feel sorry when the grace of God is upon us? No, it's opportunity. It's opportunity. But so it put me through the ringer, having to look at it that way. I really had to up my game, you know, to handle that. It's easy to go into pity. You don't have to up your game. It's easy to feel sorry for people, right? You don't have to up your game. But when you say, no, this is just the grace of God, I'm not going to feel sorry for anyone. Then you really have to up your game. Yeah, which meant I had to go to Padmasambhava. When I say had to go, well, I mean, it's like you got a problem with your golf game and you realize you got to go to Tiger Woods to solve it. You know, these golf coaches, they can't solve it. You got to go to Tiger Woods. And you say, Tiger, I need to play a round of golf with you, and I need you to fix my golf game. You know, I'm having some troubles. And he says, sure, absolutely. Let's do it right away. And you know he's going to fix it, but you know it's kind of drastic. It's, you're playing golf with Tiger Woods. That's not an easy thing to ask for. But I said, okay, I'm willing to help out. I'm willing to go play golf with Tiger Woods. I'm willing to go ask Padmasambhava for help, because for sure, he's going to fix it. He's going to fix it, for sure. You just hope, you know, he doesn't overcoach, and he doesn't. He doesn't. He doesn't say, oh, you've come to me for help? Well, let me give you all this esoteric tantric, you know, syllables and mantras and visualizations, you know, you were afraid of that, right? No. It's like you play golf with Tiger Woods. Tiger Woods and say, "Let me remake your game entirely." And she'd, no, Tiger will just, like, you know, at some point he'll just say, "You know what? Just ease up the grip on your thumb on your putter there or something, just like that. Just try that, because I see that." And then you do that, and suddenly your putting's fixed. And I'll give you a little story on Tiger Woods in the 1997, I always said 67, well, we're back to that, 67, aren't we? But the 1997 Masters, which was, without question, the greatest golf tournament in history, without question. There's nothing that can even compare to it. It was his coming out party. It was his first year on tour, and I think he was like 21 or 22. He'd just come out on tour, And he was heralded as probably this guy may be the greatest golfer of all time. He's just going to completely change golf, which he did. Well, you know, but the expectations on him were greater than any golfer in history. Nothing even came close. And everyone was saying, what is he going to do at the Masters? Tremendous viewing audience. There's more interest on that tournament than any tournament in history. And what did he do? He obliterated the course. It was the greatest tournament in history. It was his first major tournament, golf tournament, I believe. I don't know if he'd have been invited to other majors in the past. I think it was probably his first major tournament. Certainly his first Masters, I believe. I don't know if he is a maybe he ever played there before. I don't know. But as a pro, it was certainly his first major. And he told everybody, I'm going to break Jack Nicklaus's record in the majors. No doubt about it. And so everybody's saying, who is this guy? I mean, is he really that, you know, is he really all that? And so I certainly watched that tournament. I mean, the sporting world was riveted on Tiger Woods. And he obliterated the course like no one has ever obliterated in history. Now, what we don't know, he's written a book, I believe, on this. It's out already or it's coming out. I believe it's coming out soon, and there's some excerpts from in Golf Magazine put out some, Golf Digest, I think, put out some excerpts from this book coming out and some inside tidbits from it. And what really happened was he had been in a putting slump before the Masters. He wasn't putting well at all, and I've been watching his tournaments, and I saw that. I said, he's a little bit off. What's going on? Because he was just a surreally great putter, actually. If he wanted to make a putt, it was as good as in the hole. End of story. If he got that look in his eye, he said, you know what, I really want to make this putt. He is not going to miss the putt. I don't care if he's putting from halfway around the world, the putt was going in the hole. Everybody knew it, too. Everybody knew it. I mean, it's really defies conventional expectation entirely, actually. And so he'd been slumping with his putter. And he said what he did was that he went to his dad, who was his final resort coach. He was his ultimate coach. He had Butch Harmon was his coach. But for this one, Butch hadn't, he felt he needed to go to his dad because he knew his dad would fix it. But he didn't, you know, he kind of didn't want to ask his dad, like, this is kind of this thing, like, you know, maybe my golf coach can fix it, or maybe I can fix it. But he realized that this tournament is super important. This launches my career. I'm not putting good. I know my dad can fix it. So he went back to Earl Woods, who was his dad, is his dad. He's passed away, but he went back to his dad and said, Dad, Pops, called him Pops, Pops, I got a putting problem. And Pops said, I know. I've been watching you. And I know what you're doing wrong. You know, you just need to stand more upright. You need to adjust, I think, your right hand or something. You just make this little adjustment, and that'll fix it. And so Tiger said, wow. So what did he do? He went out and tried it. He changed his putting stance a little bit just before the Masters. And he started going on the practice green, and suddenly it all clicked into place. And he said, oh my God, I'm back to putting the way I used to putt. I had gotten a little low on my putting, and that's what was causing the problem. Just that little adjustment. And his pops didn't say anything other than that. He said, just, you need to get a little more upright and just move your hand, just adjust your grip just a little bit there, your hand. That's all he said about his game. That's it. Just one little tip. And that's all that Tiger needed to hear. He made that adjustment. And then he obliterated the Masters. He had no three putts the entire four rounds. Not a single three putt at the Masters. Can you believe that? I mean, I three putt just looking at it. I mean, you can eight putt there. You know, you can three putt from 2 feet. You could four putt from 2 feet. No three putts at the Masters, and the greens are like glass. So. It was just the most astonishing exhibition of golf prowess that I've ever seen, and anyone ever really seen. it wouldn't have happened if Tiger hadn't have gone to his dad and said, "Pops, I got a little problem. I've got a problem here with my putting. I know you can fix it, so I'm willing to take your advice." Boom, fixed. So we're in this situation here where, like, I was stalled out here, and I'm stuck, and I went to Padmasambhava. I said, "Padmasambhava, I know you can fix this. I'm willing to have you fix it." And he said, "Just don't choose either the peace of God or samsara. Just choose the wow. Just choose the wow. Just be interested in the wow." I said, "Oh my God, that's it. That's it. Problem fixed. Problem fixed." It's taken the pressure off of me. So I'm able to turn the chapter here. You know, be a chapter turner. I'm a chapter turner here. Okay, I've turned the chapter in the last 44 years. And then what happened? Like, wow. The 60s reemerged. I said, "Okay, the 60s? I said, "No, I'm not really interested in the 60s either. But I am interested in the wow." So I didn't get caught on the rebound. I had to be careful because I'm so sick of the last 44 years. Okay. I was just sick and tired. I am done with it. Because I know the females are just, you know, fake spirituality is just even coming from the most, you know, the biggest effort possible. You know, it's finished. I'm over. I'm done. We're done. We're done with it. And this female there at this satsang in Rishikesh, I mean, she said, "Look, this is what we're going to. Is this what you want?" And we're just, people say, "Oh my God, we're done, you know? That's it." And then we think, well, what are we going to do? We'll go back to the 60s? And then, so it's like I'm saying, huh, maybe I have to get interested in the 60s again. It's like, God, that was horrible, you know? You see, Dion, just check Dion out, his videos. I mean, Dion's been a super help, actually. Grace of God sent Dion into my life. He was the king of the 60s. And he's at this, the Seven Club or something? The video's on YouTube live. Run Around Sue. Check it out. Run Around Sue live. Run Around Sue live. Back in the 1961, he was performing at, I think it's like some club. Some, you know, club where they had drinks, sort of, you know, drinks, and people would sit around tables, and he was performing there. And so you watch this, and he's singing Run Around Sue, and then it cuts to the audience, and there's all these Run Around Sues in the audience, and you realize the whole audience is Run Around Sues, the females. And all the men are these, you know, madmen, you know, madmen, admin, you know, marketing men, right? And there's all these, you know, manly, successful corporate men there. And they're accompanied by all these runaround Sues. And he's singing this song, "Keep Away from Runaround Sue." It's like the most surreal thing you can imagine. I'm going to put a link to that at the end of this video, if I can do that. You know, you got to watch this stuff. It's really important. Right now, Dion DiMucci is a very important guy to turn the chapter. He's a very important tool that I'm using. And he's still with us. He's the hippest, coolest guy there's ever been, okay? And so he's helpful. He's helpful. Because when you see Dion singing in that club, Run Around Sue, you're not going to ever see any better setup than all that, man. I mean, that is just powerful stuff. I mean, he was cooler than Elvis, actually. Cooler than Bobby Darin. Cooler than anybody. When he's there singing, I mean, he's laying it down, you know. There's nothing that's getting to him. Now, heroin played a role in that. Yes, it did. He got addicted to heroin when he was pretty young, like, I don't know, 16 or something. Which he had to drop, ultimately. During the 60s, 63 to 68, I think, he's really struggled with it. And then 68, I believe, some around there, he turned to God and said, "God, you know, that's enough of Dion the heroin addict, and hasn't had a drug or a drink since. But, you talk about, so as we turn this chapter, we're bringing some help into the picture here. We're bringing Dion DiMucci into the picture here, okay? Because there's never been anyone hipper or cooler than Dion DiMucci, actually. King of New York streets. I mean, he's the king of cool. The king of cool. So he's laying down to these runaround Sioux, and they're like listening to this. And he's just like completely blowing their cover. I mean, it's just like, it's so extraordinary. And they're kind of nodding their heads like this. And it just shows the 60s, the 50s, 60s, the whole thing. It just absolutely blows the cover off the entire thing. Yeah. It's, totally surreal. Totally surreal. So that blows the cover on the 60s. And this streaming, this woman was really Ananda Maya Ma, the spirit of Ananda Maya Ma got into her and just blew the cover on the last 44 years and the whole guru thing. Okay. The whole fake, you know, females faking spirituality, which they can do extremely well. But it's still fake. There's nothing anyone to learn, you know. It's just you got to lose interest. Liberation comes from just simply losing interest in trying to fixate reality. There's no technique to get free at all, really. There's a technique to stabilize your realization that there's no technique. Yeah, there is that, which is the wow. Okay, interest in the wow. Just one definition for abstraction, for freedom. But other than that, there's nothing you can point to because you just lost interest in it. You just lose interest in it. That's the ultimate fact. You just lose interest in it. So we have this situation now where it's a chapter-turning time. We're in this chapter-turning time. The turnover times. We turn the chapter. And we are now in those times. And we're having this little transition period into those times. By the time we hit May 1st, May 1st actually is the final breath. And then May 2nd, we're there. Okay, we're there. So, but we're using May 1st as a target date, is we're making this transitional time. So I'm now able to talk about this, you see, thanks to the help of Padmasambhava. And, of course, Sri Sri Ananda Maya Ma blowing the cover of the last 44 years, just completely blasting it to smithereens. I mean, it's gone. But she likes to work behind the scenes. She tends to do that. She doesn't need any acknowledgement, but I give it to her anyway. That Facebook thing, you know, that was really something. I thought, this is going to bring out the best in the females around the world. There's all these pictures of Sri Sri Ananda Maya Ma. This is going to really fire them up and say, you know, I can do it, I can do it. And just the opposite happened. You know? Instead, they said, you know what? We're going back to the 60s. We're going back to the sex goddess thing. We're going back to being run around Sioux. We're going back to, you know, Donna, the prima donna, as run around Sioux. That's our decision. And I said, oh my God, I was so disappointed, you know. I said, oh, but I knew, I said, no, if I was asked to do this, Sri Sri Ananda Maya Ma asked me to do this, so it has to be grace that's happening. It can't be some defeat or collapse or anything. It can't be that. So I was not, you know, defeated by it at all. I just said, wow, this, what's going on? You know, it just blew the cover. Their cover was blown completely, which is great. So now we can get back to losing interest in the whole thing, okay? Which is the real path, is simply losing interest in it. And when we focus on that, we realize we have a familiarity bias, and that's our only problem, because we're already not interested in it, okay? So the real path is to realize that we're already not interested in it, all of us. We're already not interested in it. But familiarity bias precludes us from simply dropping all interest. So what do you do then with interest? You transfer all your interest over to just wow. Just wow. Wow is neither male nor female. It's just wow. That's all that it is. And you don't go any other definition of wow except wow. This is the practice. Now, in this new chapter, we have this ultimate practice now. This is very different than the previous chapters. We have this ultimate practice right now from the Dharma Kings. And it's available now. It's available, freely available. Anyone can do it. But you don't define wow in any other way except wow. You don't put it into any other context except wow. There's no co-context, folks, anymore, okay? That's done with. That's the last 44 years, and before that, and before that one. There isn't any co-context at all. The context of wow is wow. And I know some of you get this, okay? I know you get it. That's why I'm saying it. We have other chapter turners in the world. It's not just me. There are others out there too who are capable, ready, willing to be chapter turners. Time to turn the chapter. And it is. We all know it. We all know it, don't we? And it's done through having this ultimate spiritual practice where we refuse to put any co-context whatsoever to it. As soon as we put co-context, we're back in male and female thing, the whole thing. Okay. Oh, I'm interested in your interest. Oh, I'm interested in your interest. Oh, well, and then we're stuck. We're stuck in hope and fear, right? Immediately. This whole co-redeemer thing, God, the he, she thing. No, we're out of that. We're no longer interested in all that stuff. That was the last 44 years. The he, she thing. No, it's just the wow thing now. And that's all it is. It's not he, it's not she, it's wow. So really, we could almost... We'll see how much we can dispense with all spiritual talk whatsoever. This whole thing, how do you, what pronoun do you use to refer to God or, this? Well, is it he or is it she or is it he, she or is it... It's just wow is all there is. Wow is all there is. Okay. So these questions don't even arise anymore. All this gender stuff doesn't even arise anymore at all in this new chapter because it's now all about wow. And wow is wow. And when you hear this, you can just feel the pressure dropping off of you, can't you? You could just feel it. It's just taking the wind out of the ego's sails, isn't it? Wow is wow. Period. That's the long and the short of it. That's all there is to it. So there has to be someone, which is myself, putting this out and say, this is it, okay, and doing it and saying it so you can hear it and you realize, oh, okay, my gosh, yeah, it's chapter turning time, isn't it? Wow is wow. And I got Pabba Sambhava backing me up on this, you see. I have all the Dharma Kings backing me up and us up, all of us. But I went directly to Padmasambhava. I said, okay, whatever you say, Papa Samba, that's it. He said, just choose wow. Be interested in wow. That's it. Wow is wow. Okay. So all duality is contained in the wow. The context of wow. If you want to go dual on wow, you just say wow, wow is wow. That's all there is to it. Wow is wow. The context of wow is wow. The definition of wow is wow. And it could just completely shuts out, you know, this game we've been playing. And that's what has to be done now. Otherwise, we're just going around in circles. And when you see that, then you realize there's always just the Donna next door. Okay. And we're not interested in the Donna's not even interested in your interest. We're not interested in Donna, and Donna's not interested in our interest. And we can set this whole interest thing down in fixating reality, our freedom, except the familiarity bias, continuity bias of being interested in interest. So yeah, we have to still remain interested in something, but it cannot be this dualistic game we've been playing. It's just, we're just interested in wow, and we're not choosing either fear or love, neither one. You see, we're not choosing love, and we're not choosing fear. We're choosing wow. Now, what about all these teachers that were saying choose love and all this kind of stuff? Were they wrong? That was just the last chapter. And we needed the last chapter so that we could blow our cover on our spirituality, so we could get to the wow. So we had to go through that. We had to go through that, all right? But that's over with now. It's over with. We don't need to talk about love anymore. Our interest is just totally on wow. That's it. And so what we're really doing is putting our interest back on the totally abstract, aren't we? This is what ultimately the familiarity will grow and build and build and build with this new chapter. And we're not trying to transcend this new chapter, okay? No. Because there's nothing that can be said about, after this chapter, there's nothing that can be said about it at all. This is the final chapter, but beyond this, there's nothing we can say about it at all. So we can't even say it's transcending. We can't say that. There's nothing at all that can be said about it. So that's off. Entirely off the plate. So this is the final chapter, and we allow familiarity with the abstract to just get familiar with. That's it. And so wow is wow. Wow is wow. And yeah, we're done with all the rest of the stuff. We're done with all the love talk, the heart talk. As Ramana says, all heart talk is just talk. All love talk is just talk. All this stuff, okay. Ramana helped blow the cover on the whole thing. I mean, he's right. I mean, he really lit the fuse to all of this. Ram Maharshi, he really lit the fuse. And so we're benefiting from him so much right now to get to this final chapter. Final chapter. It's just wow. That's all there is. It's just one word. Wow is wow. There's one phrase, wow is wow, and one interest in wow. And that's all there is to the whole chapter. And so we get used to minimizing words, right? The words drop away. The complexity drops away. The structure drops away. And yet we still have this wow is wow structure and this central interest and just wow. We have an interest and just a definition of abstraction is wow. So it's a bridge. It's a bridge. The final chapter is just a bridge to that which nothing can be said about it at all. And we have to get used to not saying anything about it. Okay? There's nothing we can say at all about reality. Anything we say is totally redundant. Totally redundant. It's an absurdity, therefore. It's an absurdity. words, any words at all, from the standpoint of reality, are total absurdity. And therefore, immediately seen as completely absurd. So, there are no words for reality at all. There are no words at all. So, who's going to leap into that? No one is going to, unless, you know, just a bizarre anomaly, you might say. And we're not interested in that either. That has nothing to do with us. Bizarre, total anomaly has nothing to do with the rest of us at all. Okay? So, that's off the plate as well, totally. So we have this familiarity bias towards definition, towards structure, towards interest in trying to fixate. We have a familiarity bias. So that is the final problem we focus on. And we just, again, the chapter is just wow. We're only interested in just wow. And any context we want to put into, wow is wow. That's all there is to it. And it doesn't go any further than that. And so, yeah, I mean, we guess we put away our beads, you know? We put away our beads and we put away our mascara, you know? Or not. Doesn't matter. Or we wear our mascara and we wear our beads. But we're no longer being spiritual and we're no longer being sexy we're just being wowish. That's all there is to it. We're just wow. There's nothing other to it than that. Yeah, I mean, you got to appear some way, right? Your body still has some appearance. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, if you want to put on the 60s appearance, okay. If you want to put on the 90s appearance, okay. Or if you just want to be, you know, kind of, I don't even know what my appearance is. It's just, if you want to just be that way, nondescript, nondescript, a little of this, a little that, but just nondescript and whatever, right? Yeah. However Donna wants to dress, we all know she's still just a Donna next door, okay? That game is over, and she knows it too. So we all know what, you know, the game is up, jig is up, and there's nowhere to go except to wow. There's nowhere to go except for wow. That's it. To the wow. Wow, and wow is wow. Only wow is wow. Okay? Wow is wow and only wow is wow. That is right. But we said, wait a minute, I thought truth, of course, Merrill said truth is true and only truth is true. Nothing else is true. Yes, but that was the previous chapter. Okay, that was the previous chapter. And we had to go through that chapter to get to this chapter. That's all there is to it. So Jesus knows that. Because when he came back, 2:15, I believe in the evening between April 30th and May 1st, it is, he said, look, I'm just back now to relate with you as friends. That's it. That's all he said. He didn't talk about A Course in Miracles at all. He said, I'm back and I'm here to relate with you as friends. As a friend. I'm here to relate with you as a friend. That's all that he said. And he said, and so I said, wow. And he just held up his hands like any, you know. What's your response? And he said that, and then he just obviously is waiting for a response. And I was like looking around too. I said, okay, it's not me. I'm not going to go first. I mean, who's going to stand up? Say, okay, Jesus, I'm in. And nobody was standing up in the whole world, you know. Nobody was standing up. I was like, wow. It was very shocking. And there's a fewer shuffling around. I was kind of shuffling around. I was looking. A few others are shuffling around like, should I stand up? And they looked at me and said, maybe he's going to stand up. I look at them and said, maybe they're going to stand up. You know, so we're doing this kind of little dance, like, who's going to stand up? And meanwhile, Jesus is standing there waiting, and nobody's standing up. And I said, well, I'll go second. I see a couple are shuffling. They look like they're gonna stab. I'll wait for them. And they're looking at me saying, and they're saying the same thing. I say, I'll go second, but I think, you know, he's gonna stand up, so I'll wait for him. And then I looked, and we kind of looked at one, and I saw it. And I said, holy cow. I don't think, we could just keep playing this game, and it's not gonna go anywhere. And this is very embarrassing. I mean, Jesus is back. And no, and this is embarrassing. I mean, it's shameful. You know, I got so embarrassed and ashamed, I finally said, I don't care. And I just stood up. And I said, okay, Jesus, I'll do it. And right away, I said, great, you're my friend. And we had a talk as friends. But I was really shocked and stunned by that. I was shaking like a leaf, believe me. And I paid a price, you know, my nerves. Paid a heavy price for that. It hit me so hard, I almost didn't make it, actually. I went through the summer of, ultimately, of 2015, summer of 2015, where I after that, I was so shocked by it all that I let myself go. And I said, I'm just going to eat whatever I want to eat. You know, I tried to reward myself through food. And so I started just eating, go to the market, I just buy the best chocolate ice cream I could find. And I could, gelato this, I could find some really good stuff. I knew what the best was. And then chocolate cake, anything I wanted to eat, I started eating. Gorging on chips and dip. I better stop talking like this because I'm hungry right now. I might start doing it again, you know. And I'm tempted to, you know. The shock of turning the chapter like this, you know, it's like putting us out there. I have to keep going first, you know, and it's very devastating to my nerves, really. It's really tough. So anyway, I spent the whole summer just gorging myself and just whipped cream. I mean, I got to be very good. I mean, I could serve the best desserts imaginable. The presentation of them, I had the right cups for the ice cream. That would allow the heat of the room's glass to melt the edges of the ice cream, so you could swirl it and keep getting this sort of melted ice cream, but stuff in the middle still stayed frozen. I mean, it was just in the whipped cream and the nuts on top and everything, and every meal I'd have that. And then I'd go back for seconds and thirds. And I start eating like whole quarts, like pints of ice cream at a time. Then I'd go into quarts and I didn't stop. I said, I can eat as much as I want. It's okay. I'm tempted to go back to that actually right now. So, but no, I work too hard to, I'll go back to as much kale as I can eat. I'm going to have as much kale as I want. Yeah. It's going to be kale this time. I got as many smoothies as I want. Chocolate protein powder now. It's not the other stuff. I'm gonna try to drink as much chocolate protein powder as I want. I'm aware of this. So I ballooned up in my health. I realized that if I didn't stop, I stopped August 30th. I stopped it. I made a decision. If I didn't stop, I was gonna fail. You know, I was gonna fail. I said, well, I stood up and I accepted Jesus as a friend. I went first, and that's enough. That's good enough. I've done all that I can do. That's it. That just shocked me so bad. I don't want to do any more. And I realized that if I didn't stop this, that I wouldn't do any more. That would be it. And then I thought, you know, I wonder if there's something more. Maybe Jesus wants something more. I wonder. There might be something more down the road, and I really want to quit now, or do I want to, you know, I had to decide this. It was very difficult. I couldn't find the will to decide. So I was in this battle for about a month. I just couldn't find the will to do anything about it. Because I knew it was going to be tough. And I feel that way right now. It's like, wow, can I go, can I keep going forward? But now I realize I already have. I just choose the wow. I don't have to choose the peace of God. I'm choosing the wow. And so, yeah, I'm able to go forward. Back then, I had to choose to, you know, discipline myself and start working out and start dieting, which I did. I started dieting September 1st. It was on. And then I did that for several months, and then I started working out. And I haven't stopped since. Although this last week and a half, I've stopped working out, kind of. I had to let my body recover. You know, I was in collapse. So now I have to get the will to, push this, be a chapter turner, start pushing this out there, be a chapter turner. And this is starting, it's starting. That's my new diet, so a new, spiritual diet, so to speak. I have to start working out on that. Had to go to Padmasambhava, saying, yeah, I need help, I'm in trouble here. I mean, spirituality, we're done. We're done with it, thank God. Been there, done that. Materialism. We're done with materialism and we're done with spirituality, both. Okay, and what do we have now? Well, we still have the wow. We still have wow. We still have interest in the wow. So we're on a wow diet now. We're on a wow diet. Not even on a kale diet anymore. We're on a wow diet. Wow, diet. Oh, the wow diet. Yeah, we're on the wow diet. So, and there will be page turners. I may have already come across one, actually. I may have already come across one. Or two. They're out there. They will come out of the woodwork. They will. I may need to go play golf after this for a while, actually. And that may happen. Just like I went on a binge eating with, after going first with accepting Jesus back as a friend, which really meant it, turning the whole chapter. We're done. Done with spirituality. And doing this now, done with both spirituality and materialism, both. We're not going back to the material girl, Donna, material girl next door. We're not going back to that. None of us are. We're finished with it. We're also finished with spirituality. So now we're just interested in wow. I may need to play golf for a while, And that may happen. It's indicated that the Dharma Kings are going to do that for me. I don't know how, how do they do their stuff? They do it. That's how they do it. There's no how to it. They just do it. And that might happen, actually. It might happen. I may just go play golf for a while. And then at some point, they'll say, okay, let me get back in this. Because my nerves are, pretty shot from doing all this. I can feel it. Whew, hanging by a thread. And I said, I'll take 217 off. Really, I'm taking 217. I'll see you in 218. So I may see you in 218. As far as just doing stuff. I mean, I've done what I needed to do. It doesn't mean I won't tape, but in terms of what I'm going to do next, it may be in 218, I may just play golf for the rest of the year and give you a chance to catch your breath And you know, there may be some ancillary stuff with that. I mean, but I may need to cool it for a little while. And feel a little more secure. I mean, it's, you know, there's initially, I think people are, might be pretty, I mean, Donna might be pretty upset with me. And the gurus might be pretty upset with me, you know. And so I may just have to, you know, cool it for a while, get my confidence back, let them catch their breath, and realize, you know, it's finished, it's over, and it's a new chapter. And they'll warm up to it. They'll have to thaw out. I already got, I mean, I had one, someone accepted it, you know, someone's already accepted it in the world. With grace, you know, yeah. And then someone else didn't. Couple of guru types have already approached, and one accepted it, and one didn't. They're not quite ready. One really is very dharmic and big, huge heart, and just said, "Man, thank you so much. That's, you know, wow. You got it." And the other one kind of said, "Who are you?" Who's yet, who's still hoping that maybe spirituality is it, but I can tell they're a chapter turner also, but they're not quite ready. They're not quite ready. They're not quite ready. They're not quite ready. They'll get there. They'll get there. They'll get there. You see, so there's a lot of those in the world who are chapter turners, but they're not quite ready yet. So I can't push them too hard. I can't push them too hard. I can't just say, "Hey, turn the chapter." But I backed off, and they were okay with it. They said, "Okay, no problem, no problem." And I told them, "I'm not gonna. Don't worry. I'm not gonna push you. I'm not gonna push you." And they said, "Okay." And same thing with the Donnas. You know, I'm not gonna. The runner. You know, I'm not gonna say you gotta be running around, Sue. You gotta do this or that. You know, I don't know if, far as females, has any of them got it yet? Maybe. Yeah, maybe there's one that's already got it. I won't say who, I'm not gonna use names, but I sort of pushed them and they just said, "Yeah." You know, yeah. There is already one male and one female that's already got it. They've accepted it. That's all we need, isn't it? That's all we need. I risked it, you know. I risked it. I risked friendship. I risked everything. Holy Spirit told me, risk it. I said, "Wow, what happens if it backfires?" And it didn't backfire. But it really shook up my nerves to do that. Because I said, "Man, they might really hate it. You know, they might really hate me and hate the whole." No, they just said, "You know what? Thank you. Yeah, that's right." Yeah, I could tell in their heart, they're there, you know? They're already there. They're already there. But they're not going to go first. That's my job. That's my job. But it's a nerve-wracking job, you know, really. You know, someone's got to do it. Yeah, this I, you know, I don't like doing it, but, you know, that's just the way that it is. But I may need a rest here. I really may need a rest. We'll see. I mean, I've done what the Dharma Kings asked me to do. You know, I've done my job. In a matter of fact, I realized that I did my job, and I'm so stressed out about it. And I'm just asked, I said, "Help, you know, what and what do I see right away?" I asked the Dharma Kings for help. I see this car, and here's the license plate. And the license plate says, "Great job. Great job. GR8 job. Great job." Coming directly from the Dharma Kings and the grace of, from God, really, telling me, "You've done a great job." Doesn't get any better than that. And then I knew, and then And then along with that, I was shown I'm going to get a vacation. Yeah, a really super vacation from it all. I need a vacation from it. And I was shown that that's coming. That is coming. And I was shown that I've done a great job, and I deserve this vacation. You know, otherwise I'd keep working, you know, like crazy to keep helping out. But they're telling me, you've done a great job, time for a vacation. Wow. That really meant a lot to me. You don't get that, you know, unless you're from the Dharma Kings. You know, I didn't expect that at all. I didn't expect that at all. I mean, that's just, they didn't say you've done a good job. They said you've done a great job. And that's a big shock. Oh, wow, right there, you know, really big. I need to recover from that too. I need to recover from all this stuff. So it's very much in the cards that I will be hanging out somewhere. Like a vacation, you know, really just taking it easy and enjoying golf, you know, just living the life somehow. And I deserve it. I deserve it. Yeah, I really do. And it's just for me to catch my nerve, you know. You broke the ice, and now we're off and running, and I don't really want to, you know, I don't want to put anybody on the spot. They'll get it. They'll get it. Everyone will get it. You know, we will. I don't want to put anyone on the spot that doesn't want to be, you know, and so that we need to thaw out. The thawing out period is underway. It's underway. It's already underway. Now, physically, I'm in such good shape. I can keep pushing, you know, but my nerves are not good. And that, you know, that starts affecting my sleep. I haven't been able to sleep very well for a long time now, and really bad. And I'm run down. I'm feeling run down. And then my immune system goes down, even though I'm in good shape. So you know, I have to probably, you know, definitely I need to get the pressure off of me. And again, I could tell that initially there'll be a lot of upset towards me. You know, I don't dare push it. I was in this church recently. I talked about it in another video, and I took a pic. With my camera, it made a ding sound, you know, like click and a click. And someone kind of like, I could tell this one female was there, and she kind of like heard it, but she didn't want to say anything. So she heard it. I saw that she heard it. I said, but she didn't turn around. So I said, maybe it's okay. I did it a second time, and boy, did she turn around and give me the evil eye. Really gave me the evil eye. Man, was she upset about it. So. One was enough. Once was enough. I mean, it was enough to let her know something's up here. Okay. She knows. She knew that I got the picture. The jig is up. Game's up. But she didn't want to be pushed. She didn't want to be pushed. Okay. And then later, I saw someone outside. I agitated on a phone, talking with somebody. I don't know if it was her or not. But maybe it's something different. But the whole way that played out, it was just very agitated and talking on the phone. Like, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? I don't know what's going on. In other words, like, you know, the game is up, And initially, there's going to be a lot of turmoil and agitation. What do we do? But by the time 2:18 rolls around, that will start sorting itself out and realizing, you know, we don't know what to do, but we better do something. And then at some point, the wow is going to take off. It's going to catch on. It's going to catch on. And oh my God, this is it. Like that. But initially, it won't catch on initially. So I really can't push it at this point. It's already in the cards. You know, this whole thing is already in the cards. So I gave the notification. People, they're shocked. But I don't want to give a second push. They're going to give me the evil eye, and they're going to start. You know, I thought she was calling the cops or something on me, or like, we got it. You know, we got to. This isn't right. What has happened? Somebody desecrated the church. I said, this isn't right. They can't. You know, I thought they were calling the priest. I mean, she's like trying to. I felt she was trying to call someone authority to, you know, do something about this and stuff. And she's really very angry. This, you know, do something about this. So people have got to cool down, because there's nothing that can be done. It's finished. We're finished. The interest, we can't go back to it. So, but we have to, and they don't understand, it's familiarity bias that's driving them. But this will dawn. This will dawn now. And once they cool down, they'll take a listen and say, okay, what's the problem? I got a severe problem here. What is it? Familiarity bias. So you got to keep interest in something. Okay, but it can't be either the peace of God nor hope and fear. It can't be either love or fear. That won't work. So it has to be the wow. Just the abstract wow. Then when they start hearing that, they'll say, oh my gosh, this actually works. Grace of God. Thank you, God. So that's how it's going to play out. But I'm not going to push a second time. I'm not going to push a second time. That's enough. I don't want to get the evil eye from anybody. Really, that was scary. I was very stressed out about that. It's like Donna is saying, like, I know I'm Donna, but don't remind me. I don't know what else to be. You know, I can't be the spiritual prima donna. I can't be the sex goddess prima donna. I know I'm just Donna, but how do I maintain my interest? You know, this is scary. This is scary. You know, this is a crisis. Yeah, it's a crisis. But it's not really a crisis, because we already have the answer. So I think the world has to just go through this time where they want to see if I'm still going to say, yeah, this really is the answer. So we have to go through this waiting phase, actually, kind of, where they just want to see, is this really going to keep saying this? Really? Or is this too good to be true? It can't be that. But maybe it's too good to be true. Is it really that simple? Yes, it is. But people are going to go through a waiting game now. So I cannot stress myself out over a waiting game, you know? I have to just accept it. You know, so we'll play the waiting game. But I got to do something. I got to do something, you know? So I just go stripe it on a golf course, probably. Yeah. I'm fit enough. And when the interest, I accept it, then my health will be, well, conform to that. My health will be perfect for it, really. My knee will be perfect, my back, everything will conform to that. And as long as I spiritually accept it, okay, I got to play the waiting game now. That's my role right now. Then everything will work out perfect. And I'm coming around to it. As you can hear, as you can tell. That in itself is sort of a tough game, isn't it? The waiting game. Because they're not sure. They say, maybe he'll change his mind. You know, maybe this whole thing will collapse. Maybe it won't happen. So that puts, you know, stress on me. battle of nerves, you know, going forward here. Battle of nerves. But everyone hopes that this is true. Okay, this is the war. Everyone hopes that the WoW will still be there in 218, right? It will be. But, so, it's not like anyone's really against it. They're just thinking, this might be too good to be true, you know? So let's give it some time. Let's see what time does to it, right? Let's see what time does to it. So a little delay in there, right? That's fine, that's fine. That's to be expected. So, for me, let's see, I have to see what's next. What's next in getting to this here, getting to it. Ah, wow, 1:55, that is cool. Very symbolic right there, just looked at the time, wow. I'll just live, you know, we'll see. We'll get to it. We'll get to it. So that's the next step, getting to it. The waiting game is on. Waiting game is on. What's my diet for the waiting game? What's my exercise for the waiting game? What are my clothes for the waiting game? What's, okay, yeah, what's, how's my interaction going to be during this the waiting game? So we now play the waiting game. That's resonating with me very strong. Get to this. I'm shaking and trembling internally. You know, the nerves I can feel. Wow. You know, we've just advanced the whole thing even more. We're onto it now. We're really onto it. Which is great. Which is really, really great. For everyone. We'll play the waiting game, everyone. No problem. So now my attention is onto that. And how is that going to be? So I hear these two kids walking down the street, maybe her in the background. They say, okay, wait, okay, wait, okay, wait. Did you just hear that? Okay, let's play it this way. Okay, wait, okay, let's play it this way. Okay, wait. So there's this indecision between these two kids about what kind of game they're going to play. And it keeps saying, okay, okay, wait. Okay, wait. Again. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, wait, wait. That's the female saying, okay, wait. Okay, I'm not sure what game I'm going to play. Okay, okay, wait, I need to wait, 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 wait. Yeah. So we'll play the waiting game, is what we'll do. So this is a whole new chapter. In my life, and in everyone's life now, it's a whole new chapter. And I don't know exactly. I've been tipped off what's going to happen, but how it will take place, I don't know. But it's the waiting game, and how that will play out is, that's the next chapter in my life, you know. Here it is. Wonderful. Wow. That's tremendous. That's just tremendous. Whew. All right, well, time to find out how that plays out. So very great. That's it for